Hey everyone, David C. Anderson here, coming at you from the Knife Center, and welcome to Knife AQ. This is episode 133 of the Knife series, where I answer all your questions, sharp or dull. This week, we're taking a look at a few things, but we've got a bit of a theme going on toughness this time around. What is it exactly that makes a steel or a knife tough? Let's get into it. Hey there, everybody. If you are new to this series, what we do is we pull out comments from our comments section that happen to be in the form of questions, and we feature them in the episode. So if you have a question and you'd like it featured in a future episode, to have a chance at that happening, may I direct you towards the comments section below. First question today comes from Single Christian Cowboy. Howdy KC crew and Mr. DCA. The cowboy in his name is already coming out strong with the howdy. That's Thomas behind the camera, everyone, by the way. Say hello.
Hi.
I said say hello.
No.
All right, fine. I would enjoy an explanation of the difference between toughness and strength in regards to steels. Much obliged and have a good one. Mighty fine question you got there, sir. Well, the two things you're talking about there, toughness and strength. Toughness is what we consider a kind of a measurable attribute of steel. Strength is a little bit different. But let me back up a second, because I'm not saying this is necessarily the way you think of things, but I have heard people use the term toughness when what they really mean is edge retention, or abrasion resistance. If a knife can hold an edge a good long time, it must be tough. And actually, that's incorrect. Toughness can affect edge retention, but they are kind of two separate things. But to define toughness, we're going to go to probably the single guy who's done more for modern knife steel than anyone else these days, and that's Dr. Laren Thomas from his website Knife Steel Nerds, defining toughness as a measure of how much resistance a steel has to fracturing. So when it comes to knives, this means chipped edges or actual broken blades. That's toughness. Strength, however, isn't really a measurable attribute of the steel, unless you just call it synonymous with toughness, but I'd say strength has more to do with what's done with the steel. For instance, we have two knives here from Topps. We have the Steel Eagle 105 and the Frog Market Special. Very different knives, both of them about the same length, however, constructed with 1095 carbon steel. Looking at it from the spine, however, you can see the Frog Market Special is very, very thin, and the Steel Eagle is not. The Steel Eagle is going to be a stronger knife. We might say it'd be a tougher knife, and that would be true. The steel, however, between the two, toughness, provided, assuming they're heat treated the same way, should be the same. There's just more of it here, granting this design more strength. And that's not just the overall, backbone, the spine of the knife, but the actual grind itself. The edge and the thickness behind the edge on the Frog Market Special, being as thin as it is not going to be as resilient to deformation, or necessarily fracturing too, if it goes too far. But you've got more steel backing up the edge on the Steel Eagle. So there you go. That is, I have in the past, in fact, with this knife here, the Little Friend, our Knife Center exclusive from Boker right here, it's S9DV steel. Excellent, excellent edge retention. Not a particularly tough steel, but you do have with this design, it comes with a little bit of a thicker blade stock, thicker geometry overall, which I have described before as enhancing the toughness, or granting the steel more toughness. It may grant the overall knife a little more toughness, but the steel is just as tough as it would be if it were thinner, but the design is stronger. So maybe I'll start making sure I use the word strength more appropriately in those scenarios right there. While we're talking about folders, I do have another one to look at here, and that is the Cold Steel Engage, newly available with the Tanto Point right here. We talk about, I mentioned it's all about the other things you do with the steel that make a design strong. And the Tanto profile we see on this folder right here go to illustrate that. You've got compound grinds, hollow ground on the rear straight section, and flat ground on the leading chisel-like edge of the Tanto profile. Guess what? The edge out here at the front is going to be stronger than the edge here at the back. The steel, molecularly, metallurgically, is just as tough in both places, but it's not going to be as strong there at the back. So I hope that helps.
Say strength is how many tufts are in it.
How many tufts? So it's like strength would be, if a unit of strength was represented by a Roman legionnaire, perhaps, with their shield wall, the more legionnaires, is it the legionnaire? I may be getting the actual terminology for the soldiers in this case wrong, but the more shields in the shield wall, there you go. Toughness is measured in units of shield wall.
We'll go with that.
We'll go with that. It's science. Look it up.
And history.
Go comment on Laren's website for me about that. No, don't do that. Don't do that. That would be really silly. Don't
definitely
do that.
Definitely read it, though.
Yeah, definitely read his website. It's in the weeds. I personally like getting in the weeds, but he presents everything in a very technical manner, which is excellent because there's a lot of, let's be honest, bogus information out there on the internet. Hopefully I've not contributed too much to it over my years here at the Knife Center, but I'm always endeavoring not to, and to bow to the experts where necessary and where appropriate, and he certainly is one of those. Next question comes from Lyndon Marquis. Oh, no more cowboy talk.
Nah.
Darn tootin'. Hey, DCA, hope you're keeping well. Not too bad. I've been shaving with a straight razor for about 8 years because I enjoy both feeling smug about sustainability and self-mutilation. I like this guy. Almost all the straight razors I can find are carbon steel. Why is this? Are high-end stainless steels and or particle steels not suitable for a straight razor? Sort of. Or one could say yes to the answer there. Now, ultimately, I do have a straight razor here, a rather beautiful straight razor, which I don't think I've shown on the channel before. This one is the Dovo Straight Razor Perlex, the 5/8-inch full hollow ground carbon steel blade. $140 for this, made in Zollingen. Now, ultimately, when it comes to straight razor usage, edge retention is not necessarily the primary thing, or the most desirable characteristic in your straight razor blade is. I don't know whether that made a complete sentence or not because I lost track of it in the middle of it, but that's fine. The thing you want more than anything with a straight razor is as sharp of an edge as absolutely possible, because the sharper it is, the more comfortable it is, the closer the shave is, the less rash, the less razor burn, essentially, the less irritation on your skin. And pretty much nothing, to help maintain that, you're gonna wanna be stropping your razor, and pretty much nothing out there strops up quite as well as simple carbon steels out there. Doesn't matter if you may have to stop, once or twice in the middle to strop again. If you've got really thick beard hair, you want it to be as sharp as possible. You want it to be easy to keep it that way.
Literally hair splitting sharp.
Hair splitting sharp. There are some stainless steels out there designed to be used in this case. For instance, AEBL and Sandvik's equivalent 13C26, which were designed literally as razor blade steels initially. But carbon steel is certainly the kind of go-to. It's the classic. And guess what? That toughness, when you're dealing, part of the geometry here, we're dealing with a very, very thin edge itself. That extra toughness from a carbon steel versus most stainless steels, which tend to not be as tough, is a good thing too. More durable, less prone to fracture, etc., etc. Hope that helps. Next question's from Graham Blackall 6305, back again. Hi, sir.
Where?
I understand that grinds affect how well the knife performs in a certain role, but is technique and skill a significant factor? And pause and say almost always. For example, two of my favorite, must be a British person here, favorite channels with a U, both are bushcrafters. One values a full zero Scandi grind, and the other is zero convex. Both state that their preferred grind feathers sticks better. Your thoughts are much appreciated. I would say Yes, technique absolutely plays a significant role, but I'll back up a second to your first sentence. Grinds affect how well the knife performs in a certain role. Absolutely, go back to the first two knives we looked at here. Frog Market Special was designed as a kind of versatile kitchen knife, essentially. This does great at thin, slicing, efficient tasks. I would not want to baton wood with this. I would not want to chop with this. Whereas geometry, like you might find on the Steel Eagle, will split wood no problem. I know some folks don't like, especially in the bushcrafting circles, batoning wood. Other folks embrace it in the bushcrafting circles too. But something like this geometry is going to perform that task much better than the Frog Market Special. But I would not want to dice an onion with this. Could you do it? Yeah, I would not want to, however. Now on to the difference between a Scandi grind or a full convex here. In this particular case, I've got two knives here, the Brisa Trapper 95, formerly the Enzo Trapper, and the Felk Kneven F1 with a full height convex grind coming down to zero. I'd say between these two, which one handles feather sticks better? Depends on your skill level. And maybe it's not even skill level, because I love a Scandi grind for the way it works wood, especially, notching, big heavy cuts. Nothing kind of chisels into that type of material like a good Scandi grind, like a good knife, on a good knife like this Brisa, I should say. But for me personally, however much I like the way that does everything else related to woodworking, I can make feather sticks better with a flat ground knife with a convex edge. I don't know why, but every time I've A-B'd, and this is similar enough that between these two, I would personally feather stick better with this Felk Kneven right here. I don't know why, but every time I've tried back to back with a Scandi, spent some time then later with my flat ground knife with a convex edge, I always do feather sticks better with the other. So if your favorite YouTubers are empirically stating one is better than the other, I hope they mean, at least in their head, that it works better for them, because for someone else, it could be different. So yes, I don't know if it's saying ultimate skill, but particular skill. Does that work?
Buy one of each and find out for yourself.
There is always that too, because you will never know without experience. That's actually a great lesson with any kind of bushcrafting or survival, any kind of technique-based stuff you see on the internet or on YouTube. Get out there and experience it, and then you're gonna start to know what works for you. It's not always gonna match up with what someone says on the internet. And I know I'm compromising my position here of answering questions on the internet, but seriously, I hope that helps. Now we come to the lightning round for today. First is from Thomas Van Giel. Question for the next episode: what are your favorite blade steels for chef's knives? I've bought expensive kitchen knives only to have them break or chip with normal use. This is going to come back to geometry, I think, again. Less so about steel, but it can be about steel. A lot of folks, again, you didn't specifically bring this up, but I know a lot of folks buy expensive Japanese knives, especially. A lot of the more expensive kitchen knives often are Japanese style knives, but hey, guess what? They tend to be very thinly ground, there are exceptions of course, and tend to have very thin edges. This might not be quite a lightning round answer, but it does kind of go in with our toughness thing going on. The knives with very thin edges and very thinly angled edges, which they are typically thinner, such as on this Shun chef knife right here. I forgot to mention earlier about toughness having an impact on edge retention, because it does. The tougher a steel, the more narrow an actual sharpened edge, typically, that steel can maintain. So that will make it feel like your edge is lasting longer. But they're not going to be as tough. They're not going to be as durable. Let me use the words I said I was going to use at the beginning. It's then not going to be as strong as if that steel were ground with a more obtuse or a flatter edge, essentially. All that to say, I've experienced several times folks in my life who have bought expensive Japanese chef's knives, which are more precision cutting instruments rather than, your Western style knives, like your Wusthofs, basically, that are just blunderbusses. They're a bit more sledgehammery in a way. They can withstand more tough work, chopping through, cutting through bones and joints, that sort of thing, harder skinned vegetables. sometimes the Japanese knives treated the same way will fracture. And you don't want that. So if you are experiencing problems with your kitchen knives fracturing in this sort of scenario, I'd say stick with the simpler stainless steels, typically the stuff offered on, say, your Wusthof's or your Henkel's knives. It's like X50 MO, blah, 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 alphabet soup shenanigans there on most of those. Hope that helps. Next question comes from Jimmy Salford. I currently carry a Swiss Army Huntsman as my EDC, but I was wondering if you knew of a quality knife, sack or otherwise, that combined both the wood saw and pliers without resorting to something as big as the Swiss Champ. Thanks in advance. Unrelated to our toughness question, but that's okay. So here is the Swiss Champ. I understand you don't want something this large. The pliers are a cool tool you see on some Swiss Army knives, but the smallest one I can find right now, at least, is the Handyman. Here it is right here. It is thinner than the Swiss Champ, but it's not nearly as thin as your Huntsman, which is kind of two thick layers thinner than this. But you do have your plier, and you do have, where is it? The wood saw right there. One more option could actually come from Boker. Did we just talk about Boker? Yes, with, no, we didn't.
Yeah, we did.
Did we?
Yeah, right there, with the micro handles.
Oh yeah, right in front of me. Apologize, people. But the Boker Plus Tech Tool City 4. This also has a set of pliers, very similar to the Swiss Army knife, but it has the stronger back spring here that uses the actual back spring of the knife rather than a simple folded piece of metal. And you have your wood saw and you have a pocket clip. It's a little bit heavier than the Handyman, and taking the clip into account, it is a little bit thicker, but you could remove that and it would be a little bit thinner. Both of these maybe a little bit bulky, but if you really want those in something not too much bigger than your Huntsman, I would go with those right there. And now we come to our final question of the day, which is of course our most serious question of the day, which today comes from Werner O. Hi DCA, what's the best folding knife for making peanut butter sandwiches? I mean, it's obvious, right? It has to be the Case Peanut, right? Handy little knife. It's right there in the name. And to illustrate why I think this is the best knife for making a peanut butter sandwich, I have some supplies right over here. Here we go. I have some bread and I have some butter. Let's make a sandwich, shall we? Peanut butter sandwich. It's got to be that. Anyway, thanks for sticking around, folks. Make sure to leave your questions down in the comments below. And to get your hands on these knives, any of them you see in front of you, hopefully, you can take a look at the links in the description that will take you to KnifeCenter.com, where, of course, we've got our Knife Rewards program in place, letting you earn up to 5% back on your future knife purchases. I'm David C. Anderson from the Knife Center, signing off. And that's Thomas behind the camera. See you next time. Later.